The 35 Whelen. The question is it the poor man's 375 H&H, or is it a 30-06 on steroids? We're about to find out. Put that rock right on the ground. Hey guys, about time we covered this 35. I've been getting enough requests for it. So what is the 35 Whelen? Some people have heard about it and absolutely love it, and others are going, what the heck is a 35 Whelen? Well, Whelen was a colonel in the Army way back around 1920s, during World War I. And he was quite a soldier and one heck of a hunter and one heck of a shot. He won a lot of shooting competitions. And he was the 30-06 guy, because back in that era, of course, the 30-06 was new stuff. So he was working for the Ordnance Department, and he worked in a place called, well, it was in Philadelphia. It was called the Frank Ford Arsenal. And with him was a young man by the name of James Howe. And you'll recognize that name perhaps from Griffin and Howe. They made some really sweet custom rifles, and I think they still do, as a matter of fact. So at any rate, these two guys were in the lab working around with that 30-06, and they necked it up and down and around, and they came up with a 35 caliber that's called the 35 Whelen, after, of course, Mr. Townsend Whelen himself. Now, this guy went on to hunt just about everything with the 30-06 and the 35 Whelen, one would imagine. But he was a wilderness hunter. He got up into British Columbia by himself. I mean, he's one of these rough and tough guys who would go out with nothing but a lean-to. They say that his pack weighed about 12 pounds, and he would go out for weeks on end, living off the land the way you really can't do anymore these days. So he's a pretty exciting guy, and he became one heck of an outdoor writer, too. So he wrote very authoritatively on guns as well as hunting. So kind of, I guess you could say he's one of my mentors, because I've read some of his stuff when I was younger. And he lasted well up into his 80s. I think he didn't quit writing until he was about in probably the early 1960s. So he's got quite a history. Now, his cartridge right here, a lot of people will say he really didn't make that. But then there's some indication that he was right in there with Howe when they were designing it. At any rate, the idea was to make a 35 out of that 30-06 to compete with the 375 H&H Magnum. Now, let's think back about the era. The 30-06 came out in 1906. The 375 H&H Magnum came out of Britain in 1912. And those guys came up with the 35 Whelen in 1922. It was a wildcat, but it really took off. Even though no one chambered it commercially, people were making that rifle to fit it. But why? Well, because the 375 H&H was too expensive. See, here's the sweet thing about this 35. All it is the 30-06 necked up to 35 caliber. So it takes a 0.358 inch diameter bullet. And the weights on those bullets will run anywhere from 180 grains up to as much as 310. But the base, real best, I think, all around bullet for it is probably the 225 grain into the 250 grain. And the idea was to shoot that getting close to 375 H&H ballistics with a much smaller cartridge. Why did they want to fool around with the smaller cartridge? Well, look at the lengths of these things. This is a true magnum length action. And there were no rifles in the U.S. at that time that were really built that long. You had to get a legitimate Mauser magnum action, and they were expensive. But the 30-06, I mean, look at that matchup. The case is exactly the same length, the same head size, the diameters are all the same. All you had to do was take a Springfield 1903 military rifle, and there were a lot of them around after World War I, and you could sporterize it. And that's one of the things that Griffin and Howe did. They were sporterizing those rifles. Hemingway used one, I believe, and Teddy Roosevelt took one to Africa. So they were getting to be pretty popular. So if you could just take that 1903 action, pick it up fairly inexpensively, all you had to do was put a 35 caliber barrel on it, chamber it for that, and bingo, you were rolling. But does that really match up to the 375 H&H? Well, I've got my ballistics again, and we're going to take a look because it doesn't quite get there, but it comes close. And for North American hunting, I think it's close enough. You're probably not going to take on the dangerous game in Africa with it, although you certainly could. But here in the States, you know, if you were looking for a little more oomph than that 30-06 provided, push it up to a 35 caliber bullet, 250 grains, might work. Let's look at some numbers. So what we're going to compare is that 35 Whelen with a 250 grain nozzler partition bullet and against the 375 H&H shooting a 300 grain partition bullet and the 30-06 pushing a 220 grain partition bullet. Now let's look at all these numbers. The BC is 446 on the Whelen, and its standard or its sectional density is 0.279, not real high, and that's one of the issues with this 35. You know, you can push some fairly heavy bullets with it. It sounds like a lot, but you don't have that long bullet that's going to give you the high sectional density for deeper penetration. Might or might not be necessary. Now, the 375 H&H with that 300-grain bullet, yeah, you're getting your sectional density up there to 305. And look at the sectional density on that 30-06 with a 220-grain bullet. It's actually the highest. It's at 0.331. So if you like sectional density for deep penetration, which is what it does or contributes at least, you might be a little more interested in that 30-06. It's a surprise. So we've got, fair ballistics coefficients, but we're really not looking for a high ballistics coefficient on these because these are not going to be long-range cartridges. You're going to be doing dangerous game or bigger game in thick stuff, so elk, moose, the bigger bears in North America, the bigger antelopes in Africa. So we're not looking to throw that bullet 300 yards necessarily. So the BC is not really all that much of a concern for the wind deflection. But of course, it always contributes to retained energy downrange. The higher your ballistics coefficient on any bullet, the more efficient it's going to be at conserving its energy instead of pushing it out of the way. All right, now let's look at our 100 yards. I zeroed all of these 3 inches high at 100 yards. That's once again so you've got your maximum point blank range. And we're not going to worry too much about that. I just wanted to let you know that they're all 0.3 and none of them go higher than 4. And here is the important part, the energy. When you've got a bullet that big, you're pretty much shopping for energy, not ballistic performance. So we've got 3,086 foot-pounds of energy in that 35 Whelen, 3,632 in that 375 H&H, and just 2,708 with the 220 in the 30-06. So that's at 100 yards, of course. It's going to be a little bit higher right at the muzzle, and I've got those numbers down, muzzle energy on each one of them over on the left. So if you look fairly closely at those numbers, what jumps out at me is that we're looking at about a 10% advantage, maybe 12% advantage of the Whelen over the 30-06. And then the 375 H&H, really, it's probably getting up towards 20% better than the 35 Whelen. So that Whelen really fits kind of right in between those two. That's why I said earlier that it might be the 375 H&H for the guys who can't afford the big magnum guns, the poor man's, but it also might be a 30-06 on steroids. So I think it's an accurate assessment of it either way. So now let's just take it out to 200 yards where you have to do some longer shooting with it and see what happens. Look at those drops. Almost identical. 1.5 inches, 1.3, 1.3. And that's not a drop. That's still high because of that 3 inches high at 100 yards we did. So that tells me that you can easily shoot any of these out to 300 yards with a dead on hold. You're not going to vary much at all. 3 inches, not even. So let's look at the energy, 2,623 out of that Whelen, 3,024. So you're looking at about 400 foot-pounds more energy in the 375 H&H. And I guess anybody who's facing a charging rhino or a buffalo or an elephant's probably going to appreciate that. But I don't think it makes that much difference on a moose or an elk. Or I don't know, I guess it would on a big bear, but certainly not a black bear. So I can see why the 35 Whelen people are really appreciating that. They're getting plenty of energy for what we hunt here in North America. And then the 30-06, you know, even, I hate to say the little 30-06, but in this company it is, you've still got 2,200 foot-pounds of energy at 200 yards. And you know what we always say about elk, you'd like to have 1,500 foot-pounds of energy on an elk when your bullet lands. Well, you got more than plenty, so this should do the job, and plenty of times people have proven that. So that's more than enough energy at 200 yards. So now let's stretch it out to 300. There are plenty of people who say that 375 H&H will do a job out to 300 yards. Its ballistics are quite similar to some 30-06 loads. So let's just look at what happens there. Now we're seeing a little bit of difference in our drops, but not much. The 375 and that 30-06 are both dropping 8.3 inches. How coincidental is that? Now, obviously, you've got more energy in the 375, but the big surprise to me is that 35 Whelen, that drops an inch less than the other two. I would not have guessed that coming in. So none of them are anything you'd want to complain about. I mean, an 8-inch drop out at 300 yards, that almost makes these, well, for a moose and an elk, it would make all of these maximum point-blank range right at about 300 yards. For mule deer, whitetail, the smaller ones, you're probably going to want to stay in there at around 4 or 5 inches of drop. And that'll probably happen around 275 yards. But by golly, that's still out there at about as far as most of us shoot. So not a bad option. So let's look at my little list here. You can look on the screen. I'm going to have my 35 Whelen factoids. As I mentioned, it was in 1922. That's when it came out as the Wildcat cartridge. It was not ever in those years sold as a commercial cartridge. Remington turned this thing out, I think it was 1987 or 88, before they finally legitimized this, got the Sammy specs on it all, and started chambering it in Model 700s. So it's really a relatively new cartridge, even though it's been around since 22. And I said it was necked up from that 30-06. Now, the shoulder angle is exactly the same, and that's 17 degrees and 30 minutes of angle on the shoulders of both of these. Doesn't look like much on that Whelen because it's such a small shoulder. You're really getting that thing necked out almost to full diameter on the body. And some people will complain that that's not the best for head spacing consistently. Obviously, it works. They've got the commercial cartridge out there, and they build rifles for it, and nobody's complaining. But back in the day when it was still a Wildcat, a lot of guys followed Ackley's lead. That's P.O. Ackley, who in the 50s and 60s was making a lot of 40-degree shoulder Wildcats or improved cartridges. And a lot of people who did that said it really helps that 35 Whelen. So you're obviously shooting 300 or 0.358 inch diameter bullets, the 35. And that suggests to some people, what about the pistol bullets? Like a 350 Magnum? 357 Magnum? You can use those bullets even though they're 0.357. They're fairly short and soft. And what some guys will do is load them up with very small quantities of powder to get their powder puff loads or their meow cat loads for plinking. And you might be driving that bullet at 1,400 feet per second. And there's some loading information out there if you want to play around with it. But what that does, those pistol bullets make the 35 Whelen a pretty versatile cartridge. I didn't think that going in. I thought you just can never beat that 30-06 for versatility because of all the light bullets and heavy bullets in the 30-06. But turns out with that pistol bullet line, you can do a lot of the same stuff with the 35 Whelen. So there's the versatility you hear about. They fit the 30-06 length actions and the bolt faces, the whole routine. Here's an example of what I'm talking about on those actions. Now, this is a 30-06, a Model 70. It's got your standard action, and the cartridge overall length on the 30-06 family is 3.340 inches. But you got to have a little bit bigger. I don't know if you're going to notice a difference here. I think I can hold them both up simultaneously, but here's the 375 H&H. This is a beautiful Dakota Model 97. Got a longer action. That's your full magnum length action, and I've forgotten exactly what the inches are on that one, but maybe I can hold this guy up and we can see. Can you tell the difference on those two actions? One's a little bit longer than the other. It's about like going from a short action to a long action. You go from a long action to a magnum length action. There's the difference. And that's why that .375 Magnum wasn't real popular when it first took off. You just couldn't find the rifles for it. But man, take a standard length action like the Model 70 now, or back in those days, that 1903 military rifle, bingo, you could chamber that thing up. So that's why it works so well. Now, what about recoil? Recoil in an 8-pound rifle, about 25 to 30 foot-pounds, depending on the load. That's what this guy's doing. So it's a little more than the 30-06, a fair bit less than the 375 H&H. Let me see if I put the recoils on here. Yeah, I sure did. So, oh, there's a lot of recoil in that 375 H&H. Look at that. Recoil 51.52 foot-pounds in an 8-pound rifle. Yuck. And that compares to only 28.44 in the 30-06. And that's with that big 220-grain bullet. I mean, a lot of us think that is a lot of recoil out of a 30-06. But, oh boy, 51 out of that 375. Say, once again, that Whelen falls right in between, 33.37. Here's something interesting. You know, you hear guys say, that 375 doesn't really kick too hard. It's not a sharp kick. It's more of a push or more of a shove than it is a bite or a mule kick. I hear that all the time, and I'm really starting to get tired of it, because when I look at the numbers, and look at them right here, the feet per second on the last line of each one of these cartridges, that is the recoil velocity of the rifle. That's what's the speed coming back in your shoulder. So with the Whelen, you've got 33.37 foot-pounds of actual punch, but it's coming at you at 16.38 feet per second. Look at the 375. Coming at you at 20.36 feet per second. I don't see how more velocity can make it a gentle shove or a push instead of a sharp one. You just hear the opposite all the time. So I don't quite get that. And then, of course, you see the 30-06 is a lot less. So I don't know what that's all about, but those are the hard numbers. Maybe it's just a perception, but I'm kind of thinking it's something that we hear so often that we just repeat it. And when we walk into a 375 and shoot it, we're assuming it's going to push rather than bite. And agree that's, that, I don't know, that's what happens? I don't know. I'll have to go out and shoot some more and just see if I can't tell the difference. Right now, I don't have a 35 Whelen. In fact, don't tell anybody, but I have never hunted anything with a 35 Whelen. I don't know if I've ever even shot one. I've used the 30-06 a lot, and I've used the 375 a fair amount too. But all my buddies who love that 35 Whelen tell me that it is just absolutely outstanding. It sort of punches out of its class, and that very well could be. And a lot of them like the 225 grain bullet better than the 250. I thought, oh, I've got a 200 grain bullet here on my list. Let's look at that really quickly. That would be taking you down closer to the 180 grain bullet out of a 30-06. So what we have there is less drop, obviously, at longer ranges, only 5 inches of drop at 300 yards. So if you were seriously hunting elk, certainly mule deer, pronghorns, you know, if you're trying to get by with that 35 Whelen for all of your hunting in North America, that 200 grain bullet can give you a lot of options. So you might want to consider something like that. And another thing I should tell you is that these numbers were taken out of our hand loading manuals. Oftentimes the factory loads are not going to live up to that. They load things down because you've got a lot of rifles out there that are from the 20s. And they might not be strong enough, or at least they fear they wouldn't be, so they download it. And then the hand loading manuals will often do the same thing. You look at those and you'll say, well, looks a little bit light to me. So a lot of my friends who load for the 35 Whelen say that they're getting another 100 to 200 feet per second over what's in the handbooks. So you might want to consider that. I'm not going to give anybody any statistics on overloading your cartridge and risking something. You should always be cautious with your hand loads, because you just never know what your rifle's going to handle. Most modern steels are built so strong that they can take it, but you come up with an older rifle and you might be in some trouble. So it just pays to be cautious with this stuff all the time. You can see this box sandwiched between the two, because the 35 Whelen really is right in between the 375 and the 30-06, just back in the middle. But boy, they've just got so many more loads for it. It must be more popular than I imagined when I started my research here. So my friends aren't kidding me when they say this 35 Whelen is something to go to bat with. Now, another thing a lot of people like about it, instead of the 375 H&H, is it doesn't have the belt. And there's all kinds of people who just don't like that Magnum belt. And then they'll argue that because there's no belt on there, it is really smooth feeding. A smooth feeding cartridge is important to a lot of folks. And the 30-06, of course, is famous for feeding smoothly. And I think the 35 probably does the same thing. You've got that pretty sloped shoulder on it. It's not really sharp, so it should work just fine. Oh, another thing is, guys will say, another advantage of it is that since it's the same diameter as the 30-06, if you've got a magazine that holds 5 rounds and you switch it up to the belted Magnum, you're going to lose space for 1 round. So you only get 4 in. With the 35, you've got the poor man's 375 H&H with an extra round in the magazine, just in case it didn't work quite as well as the actual 375 H&H. Firepower, man. How can you argue against it? So that's pretty much the story on the 35 Whelen. As I said, it's just not all that popular, but it's sure beloved by anyone who has one. So if you're looking for a bigger bullet that's going to create a larger wound channel, but not have to put up with the cost and the recoil of that 375 H&H, 35 Whelen's not a bad option. I would sure look hard at it. Now, there are some other 35s out there. None of them are super popular. There's the 350 Remington, which is a short, fat Remington cartridge from the 60s that never really got real popular, but it's based on that 375 shortened quite a bit. Actually fits the short action. It has almost identical ballistics to this Whelen. So that's one option. There's the 358 Norma. The 358 Winchester is interesting. It's the 30-06 shortened down to the 308, necked out to the 35. And I have hunted with that, and that's a fun little cartridge. We're going to cover that someday. I don't have time for it now, but as you can imagine, it would be just maybe 100 feet per second slower in muzzle velocity than this Whelen, but you get it in the short action. Of course, you've still got that big bullet on there. You're going to have some recoil. With a lighter rifle, you might not want that. There's some balance things to consider here. But for now, 35 Whelen, great cartridge. If you haven't tried it, you get a chance. At least borrow somebody's rifle and shoot it. And if you can go hunting with it, report back to me and let me know if it works as well as all my friends say it does. Because they say when they put the bullet on target, that animal's not going anywhere but to dinner. Well, Ron Spomer here reporting. Once again, I want to thank all of our patrons for supporting us. If you want to join us on Patreon, just go to patreon.com, look for Ron Spomer Outdoors, and you can join our Patreon community and help make these videos. And to all our current patrons, we hats off to you guys for supporting us. We really appreciate the help. And you can catch us on ronspomeroutdoors.com. Look for us on Facebook, Instagram, the usual social media sites. But thanks for subscribing to our channel, and we'll see you next time. Meantime, of course, you're going to hunt honest and shoot straight.